Let's join in singing our theme chorus this morning. I'm on the winning side. Side say amen. Well, we're glad to have you here with us. We have many, many families, more families going on vacation again this week, but we're glad to have you here. Good to have some families visiting with us today. We're going to have a great service this morning. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you. We can come here today to sing praises unto your name, to worship you, dear Lord. We just lift your name up today, and we pray, Father, for you to speak to hearts and Father, to move in our lives, and may we be refreshed from the Word of God today. Now, bless this service, I pray, in Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus. take our hymnals, number 310, The Lily of the Valley. Let's sing of our Lord today. Would you stand together? 310 in your hymnal.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest thousand to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll.
About you this morning.
Thank you.
me on that chorus. Every promise in the book.
Reach down and get that Bible, would you? We'll do it again. Get your Bible ready.
Every promise in the book is mine.
Hold it right up there.
Every chapter, every verse, every line. All our blessings of His love divine. Every promise in the book is mine.
If you believe what you just sung, would you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Ushers are going to come to see the offering in just a moment. I was reading my devotions this morning. This last week I've been reading the book of Luke. And I read in Luke chapter 21 this story that I've read many, many times before. But it just touched my heart this morning. And he looked up and saw the rich men casting their gifts into the treasury. And he saw also a certain poor widow casting in thither two mites. And he said, of a truth I say unto you, that this poor widow hath cast in more than they all. For all these have their abundance cast in unto the offerings of God, but she of her penury, and that word penury means poverty, hath cast in all the living that she had. We see this poor widow. And she cast in two mites. You know how much that is? That's 1/40th of a penny. 1/40th of a penny. You know, she cast in, she had two. She could have just cast in one, but she cast in all of it. All of it, all she had. Just touched my heart when I read that this morning. You know, sometimes it's not how much we give. It's how much we keep for ourselves. It shows our love for the Lord. Amen? She gave it all. It just touched my heart as I was reading the Bible this morning. I thought, oh my, that dear lady, how much she loved the Lord. How much do you love the Lord? How much do you love the Lord? Ushers, why don't you come receive the offering today? Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear Lord, I pray that you would bless in the offering today. Help us to love you. Like this little widow woman loved you, dear Lord. Help us to have that same love for you. Now bless in this offering, meet the needs here at the church, Father, that we might continue to carry on the ministry, see souls saved, missionaries sent around the world. And we pray these things in Jesus' name, amen.
Page 31 in your hymnal, just before our special music. We'll sing My Jesus, I Love Thee.
My Jesus.
Heartbreak, he can't take you through.
Take your Bible, turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. We've been teaching on a series, preaching on a series on Sunday mornings, Why All the Suffering? This is part 5 of that series, Why All the Suffering? Tonight I'll be preaching from the book of Revelation and continuing to preach there. In Revelation, I think after I finish the book of Revelation, then I may go into difficult questions, preaching about difficult questions in the Bible, answering those questions. I've done that in the past. Someone said, I'm not going to tell who it was, but they said they had enough questions that would take me the rest of the year to answer. And so, but I won't say who that is down there. I like that challenge. I like to be able to do that. But tonight, you won't want to miss tonight in the book of Revelation the changes that God will make in the new heaven and the new earth. The changes that God will make in the new heaven and the new earth tonight. Then Wednesday night, we're preaching in the book of Proverbs, sayings that will make you wiser. Wednesday night, sayings that will make you wiser. There's some sayings there that we're going to look at that will make you wiser. I hope that you'll be here on Wednesday night as we preach from the book of Proverbs. But this morning, we're here on in this series, Why All the Suffering? 2 Corinthians chapter 12. I want to look at just two verses 9 and 10 here today. Chapter 12, verses 9 and 10. If you can stand with me, we'll go ahead and stand as we read the Word of God today. Verse 9, and he said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. Why all the suffering? Sometimes suffering is for testing. Sometimes it's for testing. This is the second part of this message that I started 2 weeks ago. Sometimes suffering is for testing. I'm going to finish that this morning. Sometimes God allows us to be tested. I'll explain that a little bit more in just a moment. Let's pray. Father, bless the preaching of the Word of God. There are folks here today that are probably being tested. Help us to understand why. And Father, help us to understand that Your grace is sufficient. Father, save the lost here today. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. These three men, elderly men, went to the doctor's office for a memory test. Did you ever have a memory test? Anyone ever have a memory test? Maybe you don't want to raise your hand. You say, I can't remember, right? I knew you were going to say that. As soon as I said that, I said, somebody's going to say, I can't remember. You give them? Well, Sherry, I'll give you one if you want one. They went for a memory test, and they were there in the doctor's office, and the doctor said, I'm going to ask you a question, to test you. And so he turned to the first fellow, and he says, What is 3 times 3? Maybe this is what you do, Sherry. I don't know. But he asked, What is 3 times 3? And he looked at the doctor, and he said, 274. My doctor says, well, he turned to the second guy and he said, okay, same question. What is 3 times 3? And he said, Tuesday. He said, no. Then he turned to the third guy and he said, okay, what is 3 times 3? And the guy said, 9. He said, that's good. Very good. He said, how did you come up with that? He said, well, I subtracted 274 from Tuesday. Needless to say, they didn't pass the test. Sometimes God gives us tests. God already knows the answers, doesn't he? God already knows the answers. So why does he give us these tests for? Why does he allow us to go through these tests so that we can see where we're at? Sometimes we get away from the Lord and it's so gradual, it's so subtle that we don't even see it in our own lives. And so God will send a test to help us to wake up to see where we're at. This morning you might be sitting here, but you know what? You might not be in the proper place in your spiritual life. And the Lord will send a test into your life so that you can see where you're at, because he wants you to be the very best. Amen. He wants blessing. He wants to put his blessings upon your life. But sometimes we need to be awakened. And so God allows these tests to come into our lives. Now, the first part of this message I spoke 3 weeks ago, God uses suffering to test a believer's character, first of all. God uses suffering to test a believer's humility. God sends uses suffering to test a believer's prayer life. And then I'm going to look at two more this morning. Sometimes God allows suffering to come or uses suffering in our lives to test a believer's acceptance of his grace. God will allow suffering to come into our lives to test a believer's acceptance of his grace. Look at verse 9, 2 Corinthians 12:9. And he said unto me, my what? Grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. God was using suffering to test Paul's acceptance of his grace. He's talking to Paul. Paul's talking here. Paul's writing here. And God used suffering to test Paul's acceptance of God's grace in his life. We're talking about the Apostle Paul. God was using suffering. Remember what God did? God sent him what? A thorn in the flesh, didn't he? He sent him a thorn in the flesh. And what did Paul do? He prayed three times that God would remove the thorn in his flesh. And God didn't remove the thorn in his flesh. He had it for the rest of his life. But God said this, my grace is sufficient for thee. Amen. That's what he said. I'm not going to heal you. I'm not going to take care of this thorn in the flesh. But my grace is sufficient for you, Paul. That's what he said. That's what he told him. My grace is sufficient for you to endure it. My grace is sufficient to meet all your needs. My grace is sufficient for your deepest pain. My grace is sufficient for you. Did Paul pass the test? I think that he did. Amen. I think that he did. But that was a test to see if he'd accept God's grace. And God does the same thing in our lives to see if we'll accept God's grace. Do you know the word grace is found 155 times in the New Testament? What does it mean, grace? Unmerited favor, undeserved, unearned. We don't deserve what God is going to give to us. We don't deserve it. Unearned, undeserved, unmerited. God provides for us. God gives us his grace and salvation. We are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. My friend, we don't deserve salvation, but God gives it to us. Aren't we glad for that? Amen. All we have to do by faith is trust in him, and God saves us. What a gracious Savior we have. He does it by grace. But then God uses grace to help strengthen us, to help us in our day-to-day lives when we're faced with adversity. God will give us grace to help us. God permits us to become weak. God allows suffering to come into our lives. We become weak. But then God gives us grace to strengthen us, doesn't he? He gives us grace to help us. Things happen in our lives. All kinds of things happen. I can look among here, and we've got all kinds of situations here. I prayed for you this morning, and I prayed for those situations, all of them. I was talking with Wanda. Not only did she lose her dear husband a few weeks ago, but she had another funeral that she had to attend in the meantime, besides her own husband's. So God's grace can get us through all of these things. God gives us grace. And that's what he says. God will give us grace to help us get through these difficult times in our life. God gives us grace to save us, and God gives us grace to help us in the adversity that we face in our lives every single day. God gives us grace. The Christian life, the greatest blessings will come in our lives not through substitution, but through transformation. What do I mean by that? This is what I mean by that. You get sick, you have some problems in your life, and you pray and you ask the Lord to take that sickness away from you. You want God to take that sickness away from you and give you good health back. That's substitution, amen? Substitution. Take this from me, take this sickness from me, and give me health again. That's substitution. The greatest blessings in the Christian life do not come by substitution, but by transformation. You know what transformation is? Transformation is we have that sickness, we have that trial, we have those problems, and God says, my grace is sufficient for you. You keep that, and I will give you grace to get through that, you see. That's transformation. God transforms us. Sometimes God allows us to keep those things. But you know, the greatest blessings in the Christian life comes when God allows us to keep that. You might want a substitution. You want to get rid of that. That's what most of us want. We just want to get rid of it and go back to the way things were. But sometimes God said, no, I want you to keep that. And that can be the greatest blessing in our lives, transformation. God transforms us. God changes us, and God gives us grace, the greatest blessings. What did God do with Paul? It was transformation with him, amen? God said, no, you keep this. My grace is sufficient for you. It transformed Paul. How was Paul transformed? He was transformed in that God gave him greater insight. He could see these things, amen? He could understand that. Just like he's saying right here, in my weakness I am made strong. I'm made stronger. God will give us, like he gave to Paul, he gave him insight for him to see that. God said, my grace is sufficient for you. My grace is sufficient for thee. Is it sufficient? If I ask for you to raise your hand today, if you believe that God's grace is sufficient, if I ask, and I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, but if I ask you to raise your hand, most of us would raise our hand and say, yes, we believe that God's grace is sufficient. We believe that. We believe God's word. We believe that. But I wonder how many of us really, truly believe that in our lives. I'm afraid when we get behind closed doors, things may not be the same. You know, we might raise our hand, say, yes, I believe that. But when the trouble comes and the problems come, my friend, I'm afraid some of us might get upset with the Lord. Some of us might be upset because, you know, God didn't take this infirmity away from us. And God let us keep that. And we don't want that. We want things to go back the way they were. But my friend, sometimes they don't. I'm asking you, is God's grace sufficient? That's what the Bible says. God told Paul, my grace is sufficient. Is God's grace sufficient? As I pondered this thought, I wonder how many folks really believe God's word? How many really believe that God's grace is sufficient? I've got 8 questions here. Answer these 8 questions. See if you really believe that God's grace is sufficient. See if you really believe the Bible, what the Bible has to say. Now, question number 1. If God's word does have all the answers to life's problems, if God's word does not have the answer to all of life's problems, how can it be the perfect word of God? Do you believe that God's word has all of the answers to the questions of life? Then it's the perfect word of God. The Bible says in Psalm 19 and verse 7, The law of the Lord is perfect. It is perfect. It has the answer to all of life's questions. That's why we spend so much time here. That's why we're preaching from the Word of God. Listen, we don't have to go to the psychologist and the psychiatrist, and we don't have to go to all of these other people seeking the answers to the questions of life, because we have them right here. We have them right here in the Word of God. Don't you believe that? Question number one. Question number two. Was Paul mistaken when he wrote to Timothy and told him that this was the inspired Word of God? Was he mistaken? No, he wasn't mistaken. 2 Timothy 3:16-17. All Scripture is given by what? Inspiration of God. Amen? It is the Word of God. Don't we believe it's the Word of God? I'm not standing up here today preaching from some psychology book or some other educational book. I'm preaching from the Bible. Amen? This is the Word of God. Question number three. Why does the wisdom from above need to be supplemented by the foolishness of human wisdom? Do we need to supplement the wisdom of the Word of God with man's wisdom? No. No, this is the Word of God. Amen? This is where wisdom comes from. That's why I've been telling folks, come to church on Wednesday night. We're preaching through the book of wisdom, Proverbs, amen? You want to be wise? Come and listen to the wisdom from the Word of God. The Bible says in James 3:17, but the wisdom that is from above is first pure. It's pure. Question four. If believers are complete in Christ and have been granted in Him everything pertaining to life and godliness, what more do they need? If God has told us, if believers are complete in Christ, what more do we need? We don't need any more. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 10, and ye are complete in Him. That's what the Bible says. 2 Peter 1:3. According as His divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Question number five. When Paul said, I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me, was he just talking about the little things, or was he talking about all things? All things. Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Number six, was he mistaken when he wrote, our adequacy is from God? 2 Corinthians 3:5, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. It's from God. Number seven, does God know the secrets of the heart, or does He need the insights from humanistic teaching in order to fully understand man's problems? God knows your heart, doesn't He? Do you see what I'm saying? I'm trying to get to the bottom. I'm trying to help you to see that God's grace is sufficient, isn't it? We don't need man's help. We have God's help. Psalm 44:21. Shall not God search this out? For He knoweth the secrets of the heart. Number eight. Is the Word of God really living and sharper than any two-edged sword? Okay. Hebrews 4:12. For the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. So here's the question. Is God's grace sufficient or not? Is it? Yes. It is. We can believe the word of God, can't we? It always is. I don't know what problems you're going through, but God's grace is sufficient. No matter what your problems are, no matter what your sicknesses are, no matter what your difficulties are, God's grace is sufficient. Martha and I have been going through something the last few weeks, for over a month actually, a month and a half. I mean, we went to the doctor, Moffitt, and she's got cancer in both of her eyes. They scheduled the chemo injections, and then the doctor left for a conference. So those injections were supposed to start the beginning of the month, last month. Didn't happen. We went to Moffitt, to her main caregiver there at Moffitt. And the doctor examined her and said they've got a new drug that they can use to treat lymphoma. She has primary central nervous system lymphoma of the brain. That's what it's called. Rare form of cancer. They've got actually two new drugs. She said they're very, very expensive. And so they gave us the prescription. The prescription is actually made there at Moffitt Cancer Center in Tampa. Johnson & Johnson makes it. I'm not sure how, but it's there. I think it has to be formulated right there. They provide all of the everything necessary, and then they make it. Nonetheless, they called us and said, we have this, but your copay is going to be $1,700 a month. And so they gave me a whole list of people to call, and I called all of these places all across the country to see if someone would help us with that copay. And I called them all, and everyone wanted to help. Some people had the money sufficient to do that, but it didn't relate to the disease that my wife has. So we've been waiting. We've sent in forms for Johnson & Johnson. Johnson & Johnson, we've been communicating back and forth with them. They call us again on Friday. And they said, well, we have all the forms, but some of them are not signed the way they need to be signed or not dated. And we want more tax information, because I had to send all my tax records. I had to send tax records to them. To get, they call it a grant. But this has been going on for a long time now, for weeks. You know, we could be panicking about it. We could be upset about it. But you know, we just trust in the Lord. I said, Lord, they don't even know if this drug will work for her. I'm glad. I would be glad that if it would, it would be wonderful. But we don't know. The Lord knows, doesn't he? And I understand that God's grace is sufficient. We just go on with our regular everyday lives. We're just going on, you know. We're here in church today. We got up just like we always do. Every day we get up, we do just like we always do. We're not panicking. We're not upset. We're not mad at God. We're not mad at the doctors. God knows all of this stuff, doesn't he? Don't you think if I could, I'd heal my wife? Don't you think I would like that? But we don't wake up panicked every day. We don't wake up in despair every day, but we just go on and do our everyday stuff. Why? I'll tell you why, because God's grace is sufficient. That's why. I wouldn't be standing here today. I wouldn't be able to stand here today and tell you that, because God's grace is sufficient. Sometimes we get bogged down with all of this stuff in the world, don't we? We get bogged down with all of this stuff. Don't let it bog you down, because God's grace is sufficient, I'm telling you. It will get you through day by day, moment by moment, week by week, month by month. It will get you by. We have stories right here in this place. Ask Tanya about that. You know God's grace is sufficient, don't you? God's grace is sufficient. God's grace is sufficient. It will get you through. Is God's grace sufficient? Yes. God's grace is sufficient. Sometimes suffering is for testing, isn't it? God tested Paul. I mean, one of the greatest Christians that ever lived. God tested him. Who are we that God would not test us? For us to see where we're at in our Christian lives. Sometimes God uses suffering to test a believer's acceptance of God's grace. It may be he wants to see if you will accept his grace. Will you accept his grace? Will you accept it? Number two. God uses suffering to test a believer's strength. Not only acceptance of his grace, but strength. Look at verses 9 and 10 again. Let me just go ahead and read these verses. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities. Look what he says he takes pleasure in. Infirmities and reproaches and necessities and persecutions and distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. God was using suffering to test Paul's strength, to see if he was trusting. Here it is. Are you listening? To see if he was trusting in his own strength or if he is trusting in the power of God. Sometimes God will allow testing to come in your life to see if you're trusting in your strength or if you're trusting in his strength. And I'm afraid many times we're trusting in our own strength. But we need to trust in God's strength. God is all powerful, amen? We need to trust in him, rely upon him. Paul was relying upon the power of God, not his own strength. Look what he said. I rather glory in my infirmities and the power of Christ, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. He lists five different types of adversities that he was going through. Look at the things he was going through. Infirmities. You know what infirmities are? That's sicknesses. Do you know that even Paul, the great Paul, got sick? Even Paul got sick. Sometimes we get sick, don't we? Sometimes we get sick. Even Paul got sick. That's what he says. In reproaches. What are reproaches? It's insults. Paul was insulted. In necessities. You know what necessities are? That's the necessities of life. Deprivation. Paul went without. We read the Bible. There were times that he went without. You say, you know what? Sometimes we go without. Sometimes we don't have enough. But you know what? Paul knew all about that. There were times that he didn't have enough. He didn't have the needs of life. Persecutions. That's bodily harm. We know that he was beaten. Distresses. That's difficult. Great difficulties. He had great difficulties. But what did he say? For when I am weak, then am I strong. You see, what happens when we get to these places and we realize, listen, there's nothing that I can do. I can't do anything. I am weak. Here I am. I can't do anything. Then we rely upon God's power. Amen. We realize, I can't do anything. There's nothing that I can do. in Martha's situation. We've done everything that we know to do. I know nothing more to do. All I can do is rest in the Lord and His power. Paul said, when I am weak, then I'm made strong, because we quit resting in ourselves and we start resting in the Lord. That's where the power is, relying upon Him. When I can do nothing, I'm going to rely. I can't rely upon anyone but the Lord. He will make us strong. Physical suffering, mental anguish, disappointment, unfulfillment, failure, all of these things come in our lives. And when they come into our lives and we get weak and we can't, there's nothing that we can do, and we can only turn to the Lord. And when you can only turn to the Lord, then you know what? Then it helps you get rid of those impurities in your life. Because you're going to call upon the Lord. See, when we're as long as we can do it ourselves, then we don't have to worry. We can hold on to that sin. We can hold on to those things we know we ought not to be doing. We can hold on to those things. But my friend, when you go to the Lord and you have to depend upon Him and trust in Him, you know that, man, I got to get rid of that thing in my life. Amen. I got to get right with the Lord if I want God's help. As long as we can depend upon ourselves, we can hold on to that sin in our lives. But my friend, when we're going to depend upon the Lord, we've got to get rid of that. Helps us to be right with the Lord, doesn't it? Do you see that? Helps us to be right with the Lord. We get close to the Lord. I don't know about you, but I've found in my life that seems like when God's getting ready to do something big, He sent some adversity my way, some suffering my way. I think just so I'll depend upon Him, amen? Just, have you seen that in your own life? Just so that you'll depend upon Him. I can give you stories. I was assistant pastor. I was telling these folks back here, I was assistant pastor at Trinity Baptist Church, helped start that church. Years ago, 46, probably almost 47 years ago, Trinity Baptist Church. I was assistant pastor for 6 years at that church. The church was a growing church. I worked in all the ministries of the church. As a young man, I was a music director, the youth director, the Jolly 60s director. I was a principal of school, ran a bus route. Lots of different ministries I worked in at that church. I was there for 6 years. Last year I was there, it was the end of the school year, and things were going, I thought things were going well. The school year went well. The church was growing. We had, at that church at that time, we would have some of the greatest preachers in America come and preach at our church there. Cecil Hodges came and preached at our church. Anyway, it was the end of the school year. School was closing. The pastor said to me, he said, "Brother Gary, I need to talk with you in my office." I said, "Okay." Went in his office and he said, "Brother Gary," he said, "I don't know how to tell you this." I said, "Well, just tell me. What is it?" He said, "Well, we don't have enough money to pay you for the summer." I said, "You got to be joking." "Are you joking?" I mean, they were only paying me back in those days about $300 a week. It was nothing back in that day. It was nothing. And with the church, the size that church was, I'm thinking, that's nothing. How can you not pay me? He said, "No, really, I can't pay you." He said, "I'll be able to pay you when school starts again and the revenue comes in for the school, I'll be able to, but I can't pay you for the summer." And I'm sitting there, and my heart just sank to my stomach. I'm thinking, and my wife and I had two babies. We had two babies, Dana and Nathan. And he said, "He can't pay me." And I'm working. Listen, I did not lollygag. I'm telling you, I worked 7 days a week. The whole time, 6 years I was there, never took a vacation, never took a day off for 6 years I worked that church. He said, I can't pay you this summer. He said, you think your dad will give you a job? I said, I'm sure my dad would give me a job working construction. My dad was a builder. And I said, he'll give me a job. But boy, I have 6 years in the ministry, and now I'm going to work construction work again. But I called my dad. My dad said, yes, you can work for me this summer. I said, well, I'm going to also check with Martha's brothers. I may go to Illinois and work for her brothers. They own a construction company up there. I'll work for them. So I called them. They said, yeah, you can come up here and work for us. Because Martha's mother, they wanted us to come up there, bring the babies up there and spend the summer with them. And so we went up there. I went up there and I worked 6 days a week. I'd work as many hours as I could work every day, working construction work. But God, at that moment, God said, now is the time. Now is the time. You say, now's the time for what? Now's the time to start a church. Because I'd already knew that God wanted me to start a church, because God had already called me to do that. I knew that. But he said, now is the time. And so I got ready. That summer, I worked, and I got prepared, and I got ready to start this church right here. I worked all summer getting things ready to start this church. And when I came back in August, I was a principal of that school up there, and I started this church from scratch. But you know what? God brought me through adversity to do that. Amen. I got to the place where I'm thinking, whoa, man, I got two little babies. I got to work. God brought me to that place to help me to see it's time for you to start this church. Otherwise, I'd have just kept working, you know. But you know what? God has a way of doing that. Amen. God said, now's the time, buddy. Wake up. He woke me up. Sometimes God does that. He sends that testing, doesn't he? He sends it. And you're at the very bottom. You don't know what in the world, what else can you do? There wasn't anything else I could do. I had to depend upon the Lord completely. People thought I was absolutely crazy because I'm going to come and start a church. I had no money. I had no support. I came here and started this church with not a penny. All I had was faith to believe that God was going to do it, and God wanted us to do it. That's what. That's it. You say, you're crazy, Pastor. I probably still am. Otherwise, I wouldn't be pastor in this church. Don't you see that? God sends that adversity. Sometimes, I mean, he brings that adversity. You're all the way on the bottom. There's no place else to look but to the Lord. Amen? You've got to completely depend upon his power. And I completely depend upon the power of God. People said, how can you do that? You've got two little babies and you're going to go start a church and you got no money. How can you do that? God can do it. That's how. God can do it. You know what? God did it, didn't he? God did it. If I could have thought that I could do it, it would have been a different story. But I knew that I couldn't do it, that God had to do it. And God did it. Isn't God great? Amen? Sometimes God brings us all the way to that point, doesn't he? We realize there's nothing we can do. We have to fully depend upon him. And that's what Paul says, when I am weak, then am I made strong. Sometimes we're all the way at the bottom. There's no place else to go except to the Lord. We need to trust in him. Rely upon him. He brings us all the way to that point. I had some other things I was going to say, but I'm not going to say those. A pastor from the middle states, Midwest, I should say, he told how he was in Colorado, and he's used to flatland. I'm from Michigan. I'm used to flatland. I go out in those mountains. I went to seminary in Tennessee and all those mountains. I never got used to those mountains. I would drive over Lookout Mountain every day to go to seminary. I never got used to that. This guy was in Colorado, and he was on a, it was a pastor, and he's on a little, just taking some time off. He had lots of difficulties. He was having tough times. And he was in Colorado, and he's driving down the highway, and there's a railroad, there's a railroad tracks are running parallel with the road that he's on, and there's a train running on those tracks. He's riding on this road through the mountains in Colorado, and here's this train right next to him, the tracks there and the train. And this was an unusual sight for him. Listen, it was the end of the train, and there were two locomotives pushing the train. Now, there in the Midwest, you don't see trains pushing the cars. He said the cars, have you seen these trains? We don't see a lot of trains anymore here, but he said it looked like the cars were like a mile long. And there were two locomotives, and they were pushing the train. He said, that's strange. I've never seen that before. Two locomotives pushing the train. He said, I've not seen that before. But he looked up there, and man, it was a mile long. And so he kept driving, and as he drove, he passed the train. And when he got up past the train, he looked over there, and he couldn't believe what he saw. You know what he saw? He saw five locomotives pulling the train. There were two that were pushing, and there were five that were pulling. Seven. He goes, wow, seven locomotives pulling that train. And he thought to himself, that's a picture of my life. Here I am pushing with all of my might. I'm pushing, but then there is God up in the front, and he's pulling. Why don't I just trust in God? Amen. Why don't we just trust the Lord? When we're all the way there at the bottom, like Paul was, he said, when I am weak, then am I made strong. When we're all the way there, then we have no place else to go but to the Lord. Amen? He will give us strength. He is the power to help us. There's a true story told years ago about a ship that went down in the sea. Only one survivor, and the man was washed up on the shore of a deserted island. He began to get as many supplies. Some of the things from the ship were floating up. And so he went and he'd pick those up and drag them up on shore, pick them up and drag them up on shore. He didn't know. I mean, he was all by himself on this deserted island. He didn't know where in the world he was at. He didn't know what was going to happen, how long he would be there. And so he's dragging all these things up, you know. The first thing he did was make a little hut there on the island. He made this little hut, and he put all these things that he could, find, and he put them in that hut that he made. Because he didn't know how long he's going to be there on that island. And so he made this little hut, had all these things that he found in that hut. And he was living in that little hut, and every day he would go out and he would go around the island to see if he could find more stuff, you know, just to survive. Can you imagine? He was trying to survive. One day when he was across the island looking for things, he looked across the island where his hut was, and he could see smoke ascending up in the air. And he thought, oh my. Oh my, it can't be. It can't be. It can't be. And he went running back to his hut with everything that he had gathered, everything that he had saved. And that hut was on fire. And all of his supplies were burning. He'd lost everything. Everything that he had saved, everything that he had found, everything was lost. There wasn't anything left. He just wept. He said, oh God, how could you do this? I've got nothing left. There's nothing left. Everything is gone. I have nothing left. He wept. wept himself to sleep that night, weeping. The next morning he woke up and he looked over the horizon and he saw a ship. He saw a lifeboat coming towards the island. And the men jumped off the lifeboat and they said, "We saw your smoke signal and we came." This marooned man had to lose everything. Everything had to be destroyed before he could be rescued. And I think, man, that's exactly what God's talking about here. When I am weak, then am I made strong. Because we have to depend upon the Lord. Amen. God will give us strength. My grace is sufficient for thee. Let's bow our heads, every head bowed, every eye closed. Why all the suffering? Sometimes suffering is for testing. Sometimes it's for testing.